We're here at the WAC Gallery in Waterloo, looking at Nigerian artists' works, who are all part of the Nigerian Art Society, the UK. Now, the title of this exhibition is Ariya, a Yoruba word meaning merriment, celebration. And the theme for this exhibition is a celebration of colors. So we're going to go in and speak to the artists and see what they think about their works, how they've addressed the theme, and talk about the inspiration behind their paintings. Let's go.
We're here with Chike Azuonye, who's going to talk to us about his painting, which we're standing in front of, titled Our Cosmic Neighbors. Hi, Chike. Could you please tell us a little bit about this painting in relation to the theme of this exhibition we're looking at?
Well, as you know, we have the title of this exhibition as Ariya, which means something that is beautiful, something that is bright, colorful. But beyond that, my work, apart from being beautiful and bright and colorful, has a lot of meanings. It has a very spiritual dimension to it. What I'm trying to do here is to make people aware that, from my own way of thinking, there may be other lives in other aspects of existence. So there may be life in other planets in a short form. I know that scientists have, over time, have been trying to see whether there's life in Mars and here and there, but I think that there might be life in other planets and stars, yeah.
Right. So I just wanted to know, I'm curious in terms of how you decide your palette and what colors represent each planets, if you want to call them that, or each world that this that you've depicted on this canvas. So I'm quite intrigued because I'm looking at this and I'm thinking maybe that's the moon within the blue colors, and the fact that the yellow kind of blends, overlaps it a little bit, and in all the little certain areas overlap, and these two here very removed from what's the central piece, what's in the foreground in the center. So I just wondered, in terms of how you decide what colors to use, is that from your imagination, or what are you working?
It's a dialogue between my inner self, if you know, understand what I'm saying, the inner self, the soul,
yes,
and my outer self. It's a kind of dialogue where we talk and develop this painting as it stands now, finished. And what I wanted to do in this instance is to say that there is interconnectedness between various forms of life, and whether we know it or not, there may be some connection with other terrestrial and infinitesimal life somewhere in the universe. So what we are trying to do now is to see how we can harness that on a spiritual level, and it's quite difficult. It's a very difficult concept, but you rightly said that some of them are connected, that some of them are removed. This is to show that at the moment we are still not sure which planet that have life or not. So what we're trying to do is to evolve ourselves in such a way that we begin to see, either scientifically or otherwise, whether there are other life forms in other stars, planets, and that is the concept behind this painting.
Hello. So we're here standing with Imoisi Imonigi, who's going to be talking to us in a little bit about his painting. So, could you please tell us a little bit about your painting here, and in terms of the theme, which I understand for this exhibition is Ariya, which means, it's a Yoruba word meaning merriment and celebration. So I'm looking at your painting and I'm seeing so many beautiful colors, very vibrant, and I just wondered how you could explain how that this painting style fits in with the theme.
This painting is the old Oshodi market. It's a popular Oshodi market in Lagos, in Nigeria, one of the biggest markets in Nigeria. But this market is no longer there at the moment because Governor Fashola have to clear that place and move the people away to another place. But if you look at the market, it's the soul of the town, the soul of Lagos State, because all kind of culture, diverse culture, because Nigeria is made up of different cultures. You have the Igbo, the Hausa, the Yoruba, the Edo, the Shekiri, and all sorts of cultures. All of them, have you found them here, and you can see the market is colorful. you see different kind of color, you see the celebration of people, of life, of the soul. So I think that's what the market is talking about. And what I'm saying, Effort, is that we still need this kind of market in Lagos, where different kind of people come together to meet ourselves. When you come out from your house, I'm going to market, you should know you are going to a market, not going to shops where you'll be moving from one shop to another. When you go to market, you know you are the market. That's why I call it the soul of the town.
Do you feel that since this market, Oshodi Market, is no longer in Lagos, but of course I'd imagine there are other markets within Lagos, but do you feel like there's a certain energy that is missing in a way from Lagos since this market was taken out?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There's something is missing. You understand? Despite maybe the government fed is a way of development, it's not development, because they think like copy the Western world is the development. It's never the development. We have our own culture. We need to believe in our own culture, and we need to live our life, not living another man's life.
So Ade, it's a very interesting painting, right? So I want you to please just explain to us the meaning behind this work.
Okay, it's the title of the painting is Gentrified. Coming from someone who's lived all over London, I know London consists of so many different communities, and some areas are affluent, some are poor. I have lived in borderline mostly, the good parts and just a bit of the rough parts temporarily. Yeah, and what the government is now trying to do is to push the poorer people out of London, since the country is now part of Europe. And by so doing, the prices of property in the affluent places is going up and up and up, it's going skyrocketing. And even it's now creeping into the lower parts. I call them lower parts, as financially anyway. It's creeping into that. And it's a kind of demarcation. This line here is the Thames. Yeah? And so it's a north and south divide. You'll find out that in most poor places, there are no jobs, and there's nothing good going on, and that's where you have all the booze. It's full of drinks and smokes and gambling. So I've represented all this in there. Creates bad food. Every bad thing happens down there.
So bad things don't happen in the good part?
They've pushed every bad thing down there.
Because I was intrigued, because I'm looking at the bottom half of this painting and I'm seeing things that I recognize, like, you know, cans of beer, which are, you know, Nigerian bottle beer,
yeah.
You know, Guinness, Star, Golda, Origin made it into this painting.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Union Jack flag, yeah. And, you know,
William
exactly, William Hill, the gamblers. And also, you know,
yeah.
Stella Artois, yeah. Walkers,
yeah.
All sorts of things are collaged into this very dark, you know, half of this painting, whereas the top is full of bright colors.
Yeah, bright colors. Well, what is happening is the government's trying to push everything down, you know, trying to make them unseen. That's why I have used black there and blackened them out. But it will always shine through. So, yeah, the bears represent each and every country in the world.
Yes.
Even though Origin is a brand new drink in Nigeria, still made it there, top ranking. It's all over it's all over London, or all over the poor part of London. If you go to Hyde Park and the rest of the highbrow areas, you don't see this kind of drinks there, because no one buys them there. And you don't see a betting shop there. They go to casinos to bet. You don't see, there's so many of these things you don't see up there. So it's a kind of rich and poor man's divide.
We're here with Michael Echekobar, looking at his painting titled London Summertime. Now, the title of this exhibition is Ariya, which is a Yoruba word meaning merriment, celebration. And looking at this painting, there's lots of beautiful colors going on this piece. Lots of beautiful marks being made. I can feel the energy, the movement, the gesture. Everything is very alive and vibrant. Now, I just want to know, what is your inspiration behind this painting?
Oh, it's, isn't it? Nice to know that you actually felt the mood, because that was the intention. The intention is to capture the energy, the vibrance of London as a city, especially during rush hour, during summertime. I've often wondered if people feel the same way I feel during summer. The mood tend to change. People get alerted and the energy, and you see even people waving at each other and exchanging pleasantry. So that was my inspiration for this.
I definitely get that. There is something about the sun when it's in London, and everyone's much friendlier and happy. And I must say something that's so beautiful. I really specifically like this corner because there's very kind of subtle hint in the palette, in the pinks and the blues and the way it's mixed in with the white. But I'm intrigued because there's two things going on here. You've got the very painterly style with the brush strokes, and it's almost as if you've got this very loose, free line of yellows or oranges kind of running through, which looks almost very random, whether it's deliberate or not, in terms of how you made those marks around the canvas, or if it was dripped.
Every stroke on a canvas, from my perspective, is deliberate, is intended to pass a message and capture the mood of the moment and what you're trying to depict. Like I said, the movement, especially during summertime in London, is very random. Can be structured, but can be abrupt. People go about their businesses in a very random, unconstructed way. It seems very chaotic, but then there's a sense of purpose. So that's what the style, the looseness, depicts the free spirit that is encapsulated the mood of London summertime.
No color by Debo. So we're standing in front of one of your prints you have on the show, Title Changes. I'd just like you to elaborate a little bit more about this piece.
It's a lino print, oil on paper, Japanese paper, and it's typical of the kind of work I do. It's full of symbolisms, and so I try to make my work aesthetically pleasing. So, you know, first of all, it's something that you look at and you think, yeah, I like what I see in there. Unlike some of the other paintings and things that you see here, there's a level of control and calculation in terms of what I do. There's balance. I arrange my objects around there. So there's that element that makes it a bit more rigid and more planned. There's more planning in my work than just in paintings.
I'm just looking at your piece right now, your lino print, and I've seen a lot of symbols, a lot of lines. Yeah. This element of growth to it is a plant growing, and there's this female figure right in the middle. She's very central, so she must be important.
Yeah.
She's got a three-sided face to her.
Yes.
The main face and two profiles on the side.
Yeah.
And she's holding a bowl of fruits.
Yes.
And a calabash. Yeah. In one hand.
Yeah.
So I just want to know what is it about, you know, each element of this of every symbol within this print that kind of pulls it together, and what kind of makes it.
It's the way, best way to describe this. If I tell you that that woman there is me, and what I mean by that is not just me, it's a lot of us who have come from a different land, from Nigeria to this country, whether here or in America. So in other words, it's a traveler, it's a young traveler from a distant country. That's what that figure represents. So what you see there is this person. First part of the picture, she's young. So it's a young person. I deliberately made it female because I thought female is kind of all-encompassing gender rather than a male is just male, but female it kind of has elements of both. So it's a young female, probably about 12, 13, just at the point of mature. You're not quite mature yet, just growing up and all that. She's found herself in this land. And if you look at it, the landscape sort of almost looks like barren desert land, you know, but what it symbolizes is it's clear ground, and it's a journey she's about to embark on. Now, when you look at the figure herself, you've mentioned she's got two objects. She's got that calabash, that's your drink, and you've got the bowl of fruits, that's food. If you look at the nomadic people, the sort of the bushmen and all that, if they had this, they could go away for weeks. That's enough. They sustain themselves on that. So the point of, she's got everything to move into this journey. You're well fed, you've got your stuff, go on your journey. You come up higher and you look at the mask. The mask symbolizes what I think is what I believe. When you wake up in the morning, we all put on a mask. In other words, the face we show the world isn't, you could have had a tragedy the night before, you could have been, you could be happy, you could be disappointed in a relationship and all that, but when you get out the door, I'm going to work, you put on your happy face and all that. So whatever face you give people is a mask. Whether it's makeup, whether it's what, we put on a mask, and that's the public face, if you like. That's what the Prime Minister does, that's what everybody does. Behind the mask is the real person. Now you have two faces. The two faces, the way it works is that you've got the two faces looking in two different directions. Behind this landscape is almost like a window. And people talk about window of opportunity. So I link my art to certain words. And what you have there is, if you notice the expression on this young person's face, on the one hand, she's looking towards her right-hand side. And what you see there is sort of the symbol of Western architecture. So she's looking in there, and look at the look of amazement. It's like, wow, this is, I can do stuff here. This is great. I can just be me. I can do stuff. Further ahead from there, you have this almost what I designed to be like an embryo. And inside there is like a pregnant woman. People talk about things being pregnant with ideas. So that's full of possibility. So she's excited because she's looking there. You know what? I could go there. I could get my master's. I could be a doctor, I could be this, I could build an empire, I could be the next .com person, I could, all those kind of things. It's, I just need to get going, I could do it. But of course, being African, being Nigerian, while we do that, we never let go of the past, because you have that link to it. The past behind you is always there. You have family, you have culture, you have ideas. So there's expectations, the elders. The elders stand almost in judgment. If you notice, they're very rigid. They're standing there like, mm-hmm, you watch yourself, you know. I hope you're going to church. I hope you're doing that, and you're brushing your teeth, and don't party, no drugs, don't all that. So the elders are there, there's expectation. We paid for you to come. Don't forget, you've still got to pay fees, you've still got to pay your family, your brothers, your cousins. So that's all that expectation is there. So it's beautiful. I try to make it sort of interesting and all that, but at the same time, it's very much dictating. So on there, she's silent on that side. It's like, oops, mustn't forget, must behave myself. But on the other side, so that's where you have the two sides.
There's no doubting she's going to go forth, or, you know, whoever is going to identify with her is going to go forth and conquer. So we're standing today with Kunle Adebori Oye in front of his painting, Empire State of Flocks. I just want to know, so the title today of this exhibition is Ariya, which is a Yoruba word meaning merriment, celebration. And I can see how exciting this painting looks, looking at it already, full of colors, full of life. And I just wanted to know what inspires you, what's the inspiration behind this painting?
Yes, Empire State Influx. It's a celebration of Nigeria at the end of the day. Nigeria's got a lot of cultures, a lot of tribes, a lot of societies that are combined together to form Nigeria. And when you look at Nigeria as a whole, you see that every single culture has got the different festivities and activities and so many things going on in the society. So those are the things that actually influence my decision to have a painting like this. Even though within the society, there are differences, but then that cultural activities binded Nigeria together as one.
So I'm just looking at your painting also, and I guess it's a mesh of typography. It's a bit of text going on, there's imagery, there's very abstract corners. And in terms of the decisions you make and your process in which you actually create your work, how does that start?
It's a very complex style, and it takes a very long time to produce these works. The process starts with newspaper cuttings, captions all over Nigeria about activities, political activities, cultural activities, and so a lot of things that happen within the society. So I get those captions and produce them into screen printings. And then from there, it's a very complex process, and it's a long process. So the production of the painting itself is not as tedious as it is, but the idea behind it is the key So the idea could take years for me to come to this level.
I'm quite intrigued by the title of this painting. It's called Empire State of Flux. So I wondered, how do you come about that title and what it means?
Yeah, the process of this particular painting, it's in sequence, stages. And then what I'm trying to drive out here on this particular one is to bring out all the cultural activities of Nigeria in different parts. That's why when you look at the caption, you can see the north, the south, and exactly. So it shows what's happening in the southern Nigeria and what's happening in northern Nigeria. So it's combined the whole thing to form one harmony of a society. In contrary to what we have now in Nigeria, so the north wants to go on their own way, the south wants to go their own way, Biafra wants to go their own way. But to me, Nigeria is one. And that is why, that's what this painting is all about. We all have something in common, and that is the culture. And everybody's got their different cultures, but then it binded us all together as one, as a Nigerian.
Hello, Titus, again. So we're looking at your other painting, titled As Our Mother Told Us. And something I've noticed in your paintings, they both feature two figures in it. So As Our Mother Told Us. And here we're seeing, is this a mother and a daughter washing together? I mean, I remember my days where I had to wash my clothes in boarding school in Nigeria. And it's quite, it's not an exciting thing to do. So in terms, I didn't think it was that exciting. It was quite a task, you know, being...
That is the fun. The mother and the daughter, or the father and the son. They try to pass on to them to be self-sufficient in whatsoever they're doing. Back home, I do my things myself. I sew my shoes, I sew my torn clothes, I sew the bag which I used to go to school with. But when I came down here, most of the kids can do things themselves. That's the irony of life. So what I enjoy back home, it's the interaction we have with your mother and you yourself. But here, we're so much busy that parents don't have time for their kids. Kids do their own thing, parents do their own thing.
So when you were growing up in Nigeria, was there anything in particular you did with your mother or your father that you enjoyed?
There are a lot of things. I go to farm, I uproot cassava, I do some plantations, after which I have to sell on the street, carry some goods on my head. I have to make some supplies because we're into some snacks. My mother do big snacks, meat pie, chin chin, and stuff like that. I do assist her always. That is the bond, the parental bond, which I still enjoy way back home. That some way, somehow, compare both sides, I think Africans are better off, yeah. That's what we still have to implant. We come from there, and we still have to pass such legacy also to our children over here. So they should be self-sufficient in whatever they are doing.
I agree with you. But no, I was talking about my experience where I've had to wash my clothes. I only had to do that when I went to boarding school. It's never something I ever did with my mother. Boarding school was pretty much survival of the fittest. You found your water, you washed your clothes. And sometimes there'll be scarcity of water in the whole school. But I'm quite intrigued by where this image comes from. Is this an actual existing space that you photographed and worked from?
Definitely, definitely. I'm not living just a stone throw to this location which I painted. And my cousin is living here. So the house room is somewhere here. And I was walking down to them when I saw these images. Yeah, this woman and the daughter. And when you see something that really fascinates you, where's my camera? I have to capture this scene before it goes off.
Tony Undikamu. And we're looking at your painting titled, so it's not actually a painting, excuse me. How would you describe this piece?
It's kind of a plaque made with wood, different tablets of wood woven together. Tablets.
And it's titled Man Made God Made Man.
Yeah.
So what is the inspiration behind this painting?
Lately, most of my work has been around the understanding of deity, of God. Why is everybody inclined to a belief system? And found out that all over the world, every place there's human habitation, there's always been need to believe in a supreme being. And I was having a bit of a disagreement with some of my Christian friends, and they were trying to describe God to me. And I asked them to tell me, and what they've ended up describing God to me is some man who's mean and vindictive and petty. So I told them that, now, there's a chance that human beings be able to describe God as one of them. So it's man has created God. Maybe God created man in the first place, but man's interpretation of God is totally warped. So what I've done here is I've written that God made man, okay? Which is true. Maybe, or man made God. It's possible that we actually get the whole understanding of the relationship between man and God wrong. The religions which have been a bit disappointing, if you ask me, because if you check through history, all the problems we've had in humanity has come from religion. Whatever religion, I don't want to call names, but every problem we've had with human beings, wars and things, has come from religion. So we may be reinterpreting the image of God or the concept of God in the wrong way and looking at God as another mean human being who is not forgiving, who is not loving, who is not all encompassing. So my own point is that there is a God. He is loving. He will not punish you for doing something wrong. People, somebody uses a swear word in a church, it's not a sin that is not forgivable, because God will not let that word exist. And there's no word God will hear and shiver and shudder and say, I'm going to punish this child for using such a word.
I'm intrigued as to why it's some word, right? And I'm intrigued not just by the letters I can see, you know, which spells out the title of the painting. I'm sorry, I keep calling this painting, and it's not. Which keeps spelling out the title of this plaque. And the fact that you've got almost, you get a sense that it's almost like it's a figure, almost like a crucifix as well. Yeah, and with the rings around the head. Yeah, so what was, you know, why did you choose to depict, you know, this?
Yeah, that's what tends to drag it towards religion, right? We know the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and there is the halo on his head, which is always depicted, a picture of Jesus Christ, for instance. But then, again, I'm looking at this as somebody wearing a babariga. God is like a big father. If you ask somebody to describe God, they will describe one big father who is a bigger version of us all. In a way, I tend to agree with that. God is like us. He has the same, we are made of the same substance, but it's like we are like water, while God is like the ocean. So the ocean is the massive force that can move things. While one drop of water, which is individuals, each one of us, we all make up God. So in essence, man is God.
So Hassan, we're here looking at your second montage, which you've got showing here, titled Fragments of a Lost Soul. Now, looking at this painting, there's so much going on, so much happening. I can see different images, figures I recognize, lots of texts. It's really a montage of all sorts of things. So could you please explain to us what this montage means to you?
Thank you, Helena. Basically, about a year and maybe a couple of months ago, a writer in Nigeria approached me and told me about this book he was working on. His name is Patrick Ogwejiofor, and his book is called Maiduguri Requiems. It's a book of poems which he was writing following, dedicated to his old NYC comrades who were victims of Boko Haram's insurgency in Maiduguri some years before. He wanted me to do a cover for the book. He'd seen my work previously on a number of African writer series Heinemann titles which I've illustrated, or which display my work on the covers. And when he told me to do this, it sort of dawned on me, and then sort of enhanced the realization in me that one of the biggest problems confronting Africa today is the influx of foreign religion and a misunderstanding of these religions, to the point that people are taking their lives, killing each other in the name of God, right? And choosing what they, misinterpreting the messages that the various bringers of the messages that have been the basis of the religions have brought along. And so here I've used truly an identifiable figure of His Majesty Osama bin Laden. And Osama bin Laden has got sausage to his very close to his head, which is taboo, and also got a cross right on his crown, which also is again taboo. And then also he's got various symbols that sort of give indication as to what he is trying to prophesize. But then again, the whole reason for these sort of cliche messages is the fact that the concept of what he has brought along, which has been acquired and consumed, and eventually the sort of manuscript from which other intolerant extreme religious groups such as Boko Haram have evolved their ideology, is what I'm trying to talk about. Juxtaposed against that portrait is a figure which represents a traditional African motif of a mask. And typically when an African wears a mask, they are taking on the identity of what the mask symbolizes. Usually, the mask is a symbol of an ancestor, and the concept of ancestral worship or ancestral knowledge of your ancestors, I think, is the most logical concept in the quest for seeking our maker. Because if we're able to trace our way back through generations before us, we might eventually get back to that common ancestor who we share and eventually find our way back to our maker.
So I am quite curious as to know who are these lost souls you're referring to?
The lost souls are the Africans themselves who have no knowledge or understanding of who their ancestor is. And they are lost souls because the countries themselves back beyond the last 2,000 years. Whereas Africa had a notion of divinity, of deity, and of God tens of thousands of years before Christianity or Islam came to Africa, came to our shores. And so a lost soul is a fragment of somebody else's history, of somebody else's reality, somebody else's divinity, for which they are always second best. It's not their story, it's not their heritage. They've abandoned the vestiges of their heritage that would give them a belonging and a connect to their maker. And if they're seeking spiritual ascent, then that's the best way to look, rather than looking at this warped notion of divinity that forces you to comply because of the fear factor of heavenly sort of predicament or hell predicament for not following. So it's of heaven and hell, of the good and evil of Western and Eastern religions, which are the basis of a new imperialism in Africa today.
In terms of your medium you use, what do you think it is about your process of montage or finding collected imagery that conveys the message that you want to tell, as opposed to painting or sculpting or any other means of working?
Sure. I've been painting and sculpting for very, very many years indeed. And nowadays, I see art in everything I look at. And part of my venture is to find this art as well, even in the rubbish that is abound in our homes, in our society, in and around us, you know, where we live. And I've got my post box on my wall in front of my house. And for very many years, every time I come to empty to check for my letters, it's full of junk mail. Some leaflets from some pizza delivery company, or junk from some charity shop collection, and all that kind of stuff. Stuff that I really don't need. Also, recently I've had reason to recycle the envelopes bearing my address. And so I turn them inside out. I use the immaculate designs in the envelopes as background to create these montages. The experience of experimenting is one which is certainly most rewarding to me. And I'm taking this technique further, even to third dimensional representations of sculpture.